knows nothing about the probability. The universe is probabilistic. We have to live with that. Mm-hmm. We're not comfortable with that idea.
But see, but the next model after the particle model is the field model.
Yeah.
And it works better. So if it doesn't work, you keep trying to find something that explains how things work. So that science is constantly evolving and never reaches a state of fixed dogma. And that's what's great about it is that it has to keep on shifting, as we are not satisfied with the answers. Whereas usually in Ptolemaic cosmology, there was a dogmatic truth and that was it. And if you didn't believe that, they'd burn you at the stake. And the same thing under Stalin. You know, you had to believe what the official party line was, or otherwise you would end up in a gulag or something worse.
When you hear all these politicians argue about stuff, about the budget and stuff, don't you wish somebody could stand up and say, this guy is right and this guy is wrong and this is why? I mean, we have a basically unscientific approach to most everything else that goes into this culture, and it's extremely, you get the impression that there never is an answer to the budget or to, you know, all the stuff that we argue about.
But isn't that because reality is relational? I mean, it isn't
a... If you ask a specific question, you should be able to get a specific answer. But people really are very skilled at evading and coloring things. And representing the world. They are a human attempt to represent the world, to model it, to picture it. And I think it was brilliantly done. Is it still here?
No, it's not.
It's in New York now.
Yeah.
Open last week. Yeah. But I still think that part of what we're struggling here with is that there are I'm struggling because I think it's difficult, because I don't think it's necessarily defined, but that there are a series of I'll just talk from the point of view of an artist, that one of the things that I think art does is that art, we learn how to experience what it is to be human, and in a certain way we learn how we see. We learn in a very fundamental way to see, and I think we can go back to the 15th century and the discovery of perspective. We understand now we see in a certain manner, which is informed by certain kinds of decision making, and so to me, as much as I exalt in the knowledge that you represent and that you bring, I also feel as though there are elements of choice, there are elements of consciousness, that there is this reflex, there is an area where there's this tremendous amount of reflexivity between nature and knowing. And I don't think that we have all of that understanding encapsulated, and that fascinates me. You know, I think about the whole question of what it is to know, and how do we know how to know, and who gets to ask the questions. You know, I mean, this is something which
everybody
we're very politically we've let's ask.
Doesn't everybody get to ask?
Well, no, I think that we have. I think that you know, I know I said I wasn't going to talk about this, but I think that up until I think. That the realm of physics has been a realm which has been primarily male, and that many of our questions have come.
But
from
so what? I mean, I don't see that's a big problem. I think that if I were a man, I'd be doing pretty much the same thing that I'm doing as a woman.
Well,
I love literature. I study it. I teach it.
I'm not so sure that some of the things that we're struggling with in this conversation are part of the picture which has yet to be filled in, which is not to say that the picture that has been filled in is wrong. It's just to say that perhaps there's a larger picture which also describes a greater degree of comfort in where we are and who
See,
we are and how we perceive.
If your point is that women asking questions and women entering into the fields that have been reserved to men are going to make a difference, I think that they are making a difference. I think that some people are becoming aware of how important it is that women's consciousness be incorporated into this whole endeavor of finding the answers. And I agree that where that hasn't happened, that's a real loss. But I don't think that because men have been doing some of this work that it's necessarily that different.
But the outcome would have been
different.
I'm not saying that the outcome of those questions wouldn't be different, but I think that there is an area to question about what are some of the other questions. If there were women,
what are they then? I mean,
well, I think that's part of the adventure.
What do you think they are?
Well, I think part of them are questions about consciousness and how the ability to know and that actual, you know, when the history of the knower comes together with the history of the known, what is the nature of that reaction?
You know, it's very interesting what Ina said earlier about children ask all the interesting questions. Children ask, why is the sky blue? And children ask, well, where did I come from? But children don't ever ask, what is the relation of the knower? They wait till they get to college dormitories to do that.
But what's wrong?
I really wonder if that's some sort of, all this, you know, I'm really getting out of the deep end here, but a lot of this stuff we worry about has to do with our mortality and our fear. We develop a lot of obsessive, neurotic questions that have to do with, where am I going after this is over?
But I don't think this
is... kids don't have. You got to think about that.
But I don't think I'm asking a question about death. I mean, I think there are allusions to death.
You asked a lot about soul, and I think soul is everything about death.
No, I don't think you've heard me ask one question.
Oh, I think you're all wet.
I don't think soul has something to do with it.
No, I think soul has a whole lot to do with it. I think it's one of the things that we have ignored so much in our society, and I think as a parallel, you have physics, but on this other side, you have this rising of a great interest in poetry in this country and the world.
Oh,
and
I'm sorry, I meant soul in a very limited... You don't understand, I didn't mean soul in terms of poetry. No.
I understood exactly what you
meant.
Okay. Yeah. You had a very narrow vision of soul.
No, I was talking about a narrow vision, so it doesn't mean it's my only vision.
Forget it. It's very big.
Could you make...
It's very big. It's a very big... It's so big... Sometimes you can't even grasp it, and I think science has made it very small, and that's one of the reasons why I think poetry...
Science has nothing to say about the soul. Absolutely
not. No, come on.
Well, then what's your saying?
Excuse me.
It's not fashionable
to speak of soul.
Now, come on, now get off of that.
No,
science has nothing to say about the soul.
Doesn't mean that it doesn't or doesn't exist. The implication is
that you're not supposed to talk about it
because
it is not fashionable.
Exactly.
Well, it's not within the canon.
It is not within the canon, right. I don't think a person like Teilhard de Chardin would have come about if he didn't feel that strongly in a bigger, stronger, bigger kind of sense. But it is not fashionable to talk about soul in our society today.
No, and there's 50 million murders on TV every hour.
In the large context that you are speaking of it, I think it's very fashionable, and I think it should be.
No, I don't think it's in the large.
Well, but I think one of the things that I think the one what you're saying, Alan, and what but I think. There's different language, but I think you're saying the same thing. I think that we're saying.
No, we're not.
No, we're not. I mean,
no,
what?
No,
what?
No,
Alan,
no,
just a minute.
No,
what?
No, it's not.
Okay. Well, what I just heard Alan say though is that yes, or I heard Ino say it is something which is yes. Okay, I'm struggling with who said what here, but I think you said yes that it is a very large question. And what Ino said is that yes, that then since we have 50,000 murders a day at this point, and maybe that
it's
is
not,
part about
not,
the,
it's not the same
what
thing.
Are you saying then? Okay.
No, soul is about that inner bit in yourself, that inner bit of the next person to me, that kind of exchange. And you know this, Eugene, because we've talked about this a lot. And I'm not saying this is an argumentative to put you down, but there is that bit that is not exchanged very much between people because it is not fashionable.
The area that
it is exchanged is in the area of poetry where they talk about, and I will never forget the night of hearing Patty Ann Rogers talking about a field mouse in a field in relationship to the universe.
This is great. I don't understand why you think science is I'm certainly not hostile to that.
Because you don't find it in reading about it.
But I think that it comes back.
Excuse me, I've got to pursue this.
About it.
Where do you not find it in
reading? Well, if I go to Caltech, I don't hear about it.
It's not what they do there. That doesn't mean it's everything.
Why isn't it?
Because they're interested in other questions. It doesn't mean it's the only thing in their lives. Those people go home and
they go home and they listen to music.
Excuse
music
me.
Is part
those
of
people.
Why can't soul be part of it?
But they go home and they read poetry and they do all those other things. It doesn't mean that they can't be complete people. I mean, basically, what you're saying to me is that exact thing. that I can't, it doesn't come into my work on a daily basis, but I go home and read poetry.
But I think that there
it's
is
perfectly
a,
possible.
But I think this woman's point is a really important point, and it gets back to this thing about Descartes, that in our culture, particularly since, you know, the 17th century with the rise of modern science, there was this very formalized split between the physical, the body, and the soul. And our society, although Descartes didn't decide this, our society in its official epistemology, its official recognition of what is reality, does not recognize the soul as a fundamental ontological thing. It doesn't. Mm-hmm. We have all of these, there are many, many scientists now claiming that consciousness, morality, human behavior, ethics, and any sense of religiosity is all just a secondary byproduct of the workings of neurons and genes. And what this woman is saying is that many people want to assert that the soul, a non-physical element, has actually a primary ontological significance and reality. And that is, in the official epistemological worldview of Western society, the soul is not recognized as a primary ontological reality.
Catholicism is the Pope.
No, wait a minute. One of the best examples that I've read of this is a book by Octavia Paz. It took 4 years to read the book. And this was on Juan
So Juana Inés de la Cruz.
Yes. Yes. She wrote to Newton. And she wrote about the soul of what he was doing. And my question at that reading the book was, how many other people were writing to him about that same thing? And I've never found out the answer, because I don't think she was the only one.
But he's a good example of someone who was apparently deeply religious and yet in his work he wasn't dealing with religion, but in his private life his concern was to find God in, and he did find God in the universe.
But my thing about it was, I thought it was very interesting that she, in a locked up convent,
yes,
in Mexico City, was writing to him in England.
You know, it's a very tragic life. For 20 years she had the leisure, she had her library,
yes,
she had a very good life to be a scholar. And she actually entered the convent as a way of finding a place to not be bothered and do her work. And then when the Archbishop of Mexico City, a new archbishop came in who hated her, who hated women who had a mind of their own and who were actually writing books and who was published in Spain, he really couldn't stand her. And he was having himself flagellated all the time for carnal thoughts that crossed his mind. And he hunted her down.
He took her books, he took her money, he took everything from her. She wrote to him, understanding what he was doing.
She
was
a scientist.
Correspondence.
She's a genius.
And this, to me, was fascinating. This, to me, was the wedding, to me,
But she was writing to him as a scientist was writing to another scientist. She was not writing to him in any soulful way. She would have written to Alan in exactly the same way, and he would have answered her, I'm sure.
But it didn't happen that much.
But in fact, in that time, I mean,
my question was, how many other people were doing the same thing?
You're talking about the personal reaching out to each other of people who are thinking and caring.
It's always common.
I think
have
that
you had anybody write to you from China in a poetic sort of way?
I receive a lot of letters, and some of them are poetic and some less so.
I'm talking about this inner thing that we're talking about, soul and science.
No.
Okay. That's what I'm talking
about. But you know, you rise with some indignation about scientists being uneducated or unaware of, let's say, the world of the soul and poetry. From a scientist's perspective, there is a great sort of sadness the other way, that in the community of people who study the soul and the spirit, there is very little known about science. Most of my friends who are scientists know more about, I would say, art and poetry, and care more about those things personally than many of my artist friends know or care about science. So it cuts both
ways. I think that's a really good point,
both,
actually.
Both worlds have to know about each other if there is going to be something that grows.
But I just want to make a little point
about that. I think it's
extremely important.
I think this is exactly what we're doing here.
I think it's extremely important what Alan says, that was an experience I had when I was at university, that all my artist friends, you know, whether they expected me to know exactly what they were doing with their next record or their next exhibition, and they were, and yet none of them knew anything about physics that I was doing, didn't want to. And I think there is a really big problem here that in our society it is expected, particularly today, that everyone will have some sort of general artistic sensibility, but not necessarily a scientific one. But it's an irony, because at the same time that you have that operating among the general populace, if you look at the funding that our society provides, we provide literally tens of billions of dollars a year overall to science funding. And how much does the NEA give to arts funding? You know, it's $100 million or something.
But, there's a mystery about that. The reason a lot of people kind of say, oh, I don't like science, it's destroyed the good parts of life and things. But you live in the modern world, you choose it. And so almost everybody on this planet is choosing it. And I'm not making a judgment that that's right. But this world, these conveniences, this comfort, this health, all these things that we enjoy are a product of science. You cannot basically just take the product without accepting, how it got here. That's why we spend tens of billions of dollars, because people want that stuff.
But what you can, but I think...
They want that more than they want art. I regret that.
You can have, but that's, the thing is,
there's
you can have science.
For art in France, by the way.
But you can have science. You can have the instrumental technological producing. You can have science with all of that instrumentality and the fabulous technologies that we all want and don't want to give up. Without necessarily that, to have that does not demand that you take on board the currently prevalent philosophy of nature. Because that's about, that comes from science. Because the point I want to make is that science, we could interpret nature in different ways and still have the same instrumental science, but not necessarily have the same philosophical interpretation of what underlies that. For instance, you can study physics and you can have all the, produce fabulous things like microchips and lasers and aeroplanes that fly and internal combustion engines, without ever making what is in fact a philosophical leap, that there is no such thing as a spirit world.
But
there's no reason why
how many of you saw in today's LA Times in the science section a photograph of a mouse with a human ear growing out of it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, okay, now I want to ask Margaret something, because I think she's in a key position.
But
this is the thought. I am getting back to it, because you are one of the people who can make this difference in the world. When you wrote the science programs that were produced on television, 9 series, you were in a position there to talk about science and physics, and did they give you freedom to humanize, to put a little soul into that? Could you talk about that experience?
But I'd like to go back to, I think we didn't quite finish what you said. Were you finished with what you said?
No.
Okay.
I think the thing is that there are two things that are not often separated in the discussion about science. And Alan is perfectly right that science has given us these tremendous things, and we wouldn't have electricity. I mean, that to me is the great thing. Without
the modern
physics,
world at all,
we would not
the
have electricity. And no one wants to give that up. So we don't want to give up science, and we do want to keep funding science. But it is one thing to have to pursue science as an active, practical thing. It is another thing to then make a philosophical, a philosophical leap to decide, to determine that there is what the underlying metaphysics is. And what I want to dispute is that it is necessary, if one accepts science, to accept what is the metaphysical statement that there is no such thing as soul. I spent 6 years doing physics and mathematics, and I certainly believe in the soul as a primary ontological thing in the world. As
can
a primary
you show
part
me a
of
science book where it says that point blank?
No, because it's not about science. Because it comes back to this woman's point about what is the criterion of proof? Now, the whole point is that you cannot scientifically prove the existence of the soul, because as Descartes and Francis Bacon articulated in the 17th century, the scientific method was developed to articulate the physical realm. It was very specifically and pointedly developed only to articulate that realm. And so the whole methodology was pointedly designed not to articulate this realm. Now, I can tell you that there are actually people at the moment who claim that they are actually trying to, through the methodologies of mathematics, articulate the nature of mind. They are people from the Lacanian school of psychoanalysis, which most scientists, particularly in America, would say isn't science. On the continent, they have respected scientific status. Personally, I don't care whether you call them scientists or not. I actually think that's not the issue. I think the issue is, do we accept other methodologies as legitimate methodologies for talking about the world around us, or is science the only methodology? See, it's my contention that we can have the methodology of science and all of the wonderful things that we get from that, and we can have other methodologies as well. We should not be put into the position of having to say only this methodology and only the things that it can articulate. So I agree with you. You can't go out and empirically measure the existence of the soul. But I don't think that that's what we should be trying to do. And I don't think that that's the criterion of proof that is appropriate for that realm.
If proof is not appropriate to that realm, then it comes back to my point that you're in a position, the artists are in a position, the people talking science, meaning science or whatever, are in a position to introduce into science a discourse that would include the soul. So my question is, can you tell us from your experience how you have been working to do this?
Well, I should make a distinction here that there's one thing to introduce that discourse about science into the public arena and one thing to introduce it into the realm of science itself. So what I've been trying to articulate in my work is a broader discussion about science in the public arena. Scientists, as a general rule, don't necessarily want to have that discussion.
But how have you been able to bring this to the attention of the public?
Well, through, for instance, writing my book, which is a cultural history of physics, which does try to sort of show how the emergence of scientific ideas, for instance, the idea that the heliocentric cosmology, that the sun, not the earth, is at the center of the universe. In my book, I tried to show you how that came about, not just as an internal problem in science, but as an external phenomena, that things came into science from the culture that precipitated people to ask questions in a new way, to want to start questioning how we see the cosmos. So that what I try to show in my book is that science is not just what's called an internal activity, it's an external cultural activity that is informed by the kind of cultural influences that are also influencing artists and politicians and political movements and writers. So that science too actually is part of the whole tapestry of human culture. And that's, I think, the discourse that needs to take place, and I would like to see it take place actually within science. I mean, I did 6 years of physics and mathematics at university, and we never had any history or philosophy of science. We were never given any conception that science was a cultural program. And I can tell you that since doing the research for my book and actually reading about the history and culture, I understand the physics better. I actually understand relativity better now through understanding the cultural and historical context of it than I ever understood when it was simply taught to me as a set of equations.
I agree that my university experience was also extremely lacking in the kind of things that I happen to be teaching now, because I think it's important. So I teach survey courses that begin with the Sumerians and end in the 20th century, and I think it's good. But how do you introduce the question of soul then? Are you simply talking about a cultural evolution, or is there a deeper question?
I don't actually think it is a cultural evolution. I think it's a cultural revolution. I mean, I do think a revolution happened from the 17th to the 18th century. A revolution happened where the soul and the psychic realm in general came to be seen not as a primary phenomenon, but as a secondary byproduct of the real world, which is now considered to be the material world. And I think we need the flip side of that to happen, that we simply need to assert the primacy of that realm, which which is not to in any way diminish the physical. It's just to simply say, to actively, I mean, there's no middle ground here. Either you believe in the primacy of a non-physical, psychic, spiritual dimension to nature, or you don't. And I think that there is simply a need to do the reverse of what actually happened back then, and for more and more people to assert that it is primary.
It's up to every person. I don't understand. Is this a movement? Are we going to make people assert this?
No, but to say that it is okay to hold, to say that it truly is okay to hold this view, and to discuss it as a category of the real.
You're telling me what I
tell. It's not written. It's an air. It's a
new. No, sorry, but it is written. It is written. Sorry, but it is written. I mean, I don't have the books on me, but I mean, I've got a huge library of physics books at home. I could open up 10 of them and quote you physics.
And how many people in this society think read those books? Do you think that's why they believe what they believe?
But
the problem is that the ideas that are discussed permeate into the society with politicians and live kind of in a, especially in this country, where since it is so separate and since it is so scientifically based, then the society discards so much of the individual in its social structure. And we have the problems, I think, that we're having right now because of that.
I really understand how you can say this. When we live in a society where you can take any poll and find out that more people believe in ghosts than the Big Bang. We live in a society that believes more in the spiritual world than it does in science.
Can I get government funding and tenure at Cal Poly?
Would you want it to?
That's not the point I'm making.
Try me again.
The point I'm making is that the cultural belief basically rules the country or universe or whatever you want to call it. I'm not going to define it as just America because our structure has, we have inherited it from Western civilization. It's traceable. It's clear. European Hudson, we wrote a Declaration of Independence, the Bill of Rights, we've got America. Okay, so that's, I'm looking at it that way. The scientific part of it is part of it, which came along that way. And because of its very strict ideology of you have to prove this and it has to be done this way, and it's, this is real and it's, this is not real. And feelings are not real because you can't really see them. But
feelings are real.
But they are.
Feelings are real.
Can't tell us to a marketing person.
That's not true. There's a lot of psychology in America. There's a lot of studies done and win-win. And they're trying, too, to bring in feelings and create. You know, there's something that we really haven't talked about tonight, which is a little more rational than soul, which really hasn't been defined. No one even has said the word love. But think about ethics.
Well, ethics may be the better word than feelings, or soul is the thing that we don't, that's just, that part. Because we have so much like disassociated with a reality, individuals have become so alienated. Okay, then you have the problem within the society of how to deal with one another. And I think that's a very real way, or real evident way of seeing the biggest problem.
But see, all the energy that's going into our culture isn't because it's going into science. It's like, why are we not an ethical society? Why is television teaching us all about murder all the time?
Because of science.
Why isn't it teaching us how parents should relate to children? That's a real tough one. And everything hinges on that.
Well,
if you trust your...
That's because of the capitalistic aspect.
But maybe that's also... I mean,
I think that at this time in history, there's a greater democracy of ideas at this time in history than has ever been. There are lots of ideas out there and lots of choices. Never has there been more freedom to choose to believe what you want to believe, to follow your own spirit. Never. And if people are doing these things that you find objectionable, You have to understand, you have to ask the question, why are they choosing that? There is not a structure, I believe, imposing this order as you seem to think. It's capitalism working this, and it's science working that. I think people are choosing this. They may be making rotten choices, but that's a good question, why?
No, but the, but I think
talking about the structure of science itself, and what Margaret is talking about is there an elasticity to include things that have not been included before?
What would you say? It is science is a discipline,
yes.
In the same way that Zen Buddhism is a discipline. It does certain things. Would you go say to a Zen Buddhist, you must incorporate more about Jesus Christ into your religion. You are not really opening yourself up. It is a discipline that does certain things. We are very happy with what it does. It has to.
Where did those parameters come from?
We don't get together in meetings and decide on it. It is something that developed by trial and error.
And I think that Margaret's perspective of the history of the absence of women in that development is a factor that could change how that would have developed.
And we shall see.
But, you know,
but women have been involved.
Much more important than science, then politics is where women should be active, and we should all be active.
You're saying that women shouldn't
be
active in science? No,
no, I'm not saying that, but I'm saying that the kind of accusations that are now being thrown. No,
I don't think it is.
It is a kind of, you know, you're saying that science is excluding things, and my what I'm hearing is that we're all aware that there's some really severe social problems in this country and the world. And you're saying that science should be solving those problems, and I think to some degree, you know, there are fields, but why aren't we, all of us, really actively involved in trying to solve those questions? We're all like blaming this, blaming that, and
but I think
that's not, I was making more an observation.
What'd you say right there?
Sounds a little bit
but
like
you said, like science is incomplete. That's what I keep hearing. Science is incomplete. It needs to become.
It is.
That is a statement.
But
it's
not that the statement is wrong. It's not that science is incomplete. Science is complete unto itself. The point is there something other than itself?
Yeah.
It's not that science is incomplete. That's not what I'm arguing. It's whether or not we need, I mean, science might be incomplete, that is a question, but that's not the point we're discussing. It's whether there is something completely outside of science that ought to also be included in our conception of the real. And I mean, this Alan made a very interesting point before that I think we do actually need to take up, which is that we do live in a society where there's tremendous variety of belief. There are probably more people who believe in ghosts than the Big Bang. 40% of Americans do believe that mankind was created pretty much in the same state within the last 10,000 years. So there is this incredible, on one hand, sort of non-belief in science out there. I mean, as the rise of Christian fundamentalism proves. But what matters, and I think one of the things that this discussion has been about, although it's never been formally articulated, is that science is the officially state-supported conception of reality. It's what we get taught at school. It's what gets presented on the news. It's what gets presented in PBS science documentaries.
It's what gets funded.
It's what gets funded, and it's what's in any encyclopedia that you open up as our description of the world. But there are, in fact, many, many other systems outside that official structure. And one of the interesting things that's going on in America today is the demand by religious groups that they want to be included in the official structure because they want to be able to bring their view of the world, i.e. the creationist view of the world, into the school classroom. And that's precisely what the battle is. It's not about, as Alan said, you are free to believe in our society, and people do believe. We have tremendous freedom of belief, but we also do have, and we probably need in some sense, to have an official world view. That certainly, if we're going to have a coherent education system, we need that. And the official worldview of our society is provided by science, and part of that official worldview at this point in history, and it hasn't always been that way in the past, and it wasn't in the time of Newton himself, but the official worldview provided by science that is supported by the state and state funding in the education system does exclude anything like the soul. And so the question is, can we have science plus an official worldview that does incorporate this other thing as well? And my answer to that is, well, I don't see any reason why not. It seems to me that that's an entirely supportable thing without necessarily incorporating the Christian dogma of fundamentalism. I mean, it is one of the things that I was trying to raise before, because I think it comes back to a lot of these issues, is the whole question of belief. We've discussed belief in terms of other things, but we haven't discussed belief in terms of science. Science discovers things about an external world, but it also is very much perceived by the process of belief. And at any point in time, scientists themselves have a set of beliefs which they can't prove a priori either. And that's a necessary part of the process of science. So one of the things we have to recognise is that science too is a belief system. And I'd like to just make a very concrete example of this, one that we have discussed this evening, which is dark matter. Nobody has held a piece of dark matter in their hand. Nobody, they've proposed all these particles, axions, you know, blah, 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 neutrinos. Nobody has yet demonstrated that this in fact is dark matter. Nobody even knows that this dark matter actually really exists. It may be that there is some fundamental misunderstanding in our understanding of gravity. That is still a possibility. So scientists at the moment believe in dark matter. It's a reasonable belief, but it's still a belief at this point.
But it will either be found to be real or not.
No, but the point is that at this point in time, scientists have that belief, and I think it is an important...
It's a model that they're entertaining. Yeah. They don't believe it the way...
A belief is something that doesn't change.
Yeah, it's
no. I think that's a very, very naive view of belief.
Well, a belief can evolve in your head about, you know, how you believe in something, but I mean, if somebody says she believes in angels. I don't think you can convince
people don't change their beliefs. People who believe those things die.
Well, I changed my beliefs in science. I mean, things that I believed. I mean, because they turned out to be wrong.
Okay.
But I think it's very hard to talk to somebody who believes.
Oh, I don't know if I agree. I think culture is about evolving and changing beliefs.
I mean, not because individual people change their beliefs, but because as a group, people who believe those things die off.
There's a certain
people
certain
did not. It was not demonstrated cynical to people that the Earth was round and not flat. The people who believed that the world was flat died, and children who knew better grew up. And that is a big part of evolution.
But there are beliefs that are associated with religion that are
yes.
articles of faith, and they
yes.
do not
there
change.
Are,
but there are beliefs associated with
but
science, too.
Here.
One
but
of which is that there is no such thing as an immaterial soul. That's a belief. It's not. It's not something that you can prove
but
a priori.
I don't see where that is. You know, individual scientists feel differently about that.
Yeah.
How can you say
yeah,
that? It is an opinion of science. I feel differently about it than the 16 people who work in my building.
It's true, but it is part of the belief system of science that is encoded in the official literature of our culture, in the encyclopedias and the school textbooks.
I don't know how you can say no to that. Even the way we learn science is that it's the law. We're not even taught science in school.
Well, no, I agree that the way things are taught in school is terrible, and we need completely different ways of teaching about reality.
I don't think that any scientist has written something for, say, education in K-12 that says there is no soul. There is no soul.
Stuart Kaufman, the world's leading mathematical biologist, has a new book out where he asserts just that.
But it's his opinion. That does not represent science as an enterprise because somebody publishes a book.
But I think, for instance, if we look at our system of education, and I think if we look at our system of education, the discussion of religion, which has been the cultural discussion of the soul, is put outside the realm of education. And I think I just want to say that we have to be very careful here because we have a scientist here. I don't want you to become the lightning rod for certain kinds of. I think one of the things that I'm hearing is a certain kind of cultural dissatisfaction, which is being focused in the room with the inequities of the system of which where belief and questioning and intuition becomes funded and becomes a process of moving towards certainty. And at this point in our culture, a massive amount of our investment in our economic investment is in our science. So maybe one of the things that is being brought forth here is a certain amount of dissatisfaction with that state of affairs.
But it's funding in science because we expect science to deliver.
We want those
the goods.
Things.
Yeah.
I don't think it's because we believe in science. What a wonderful thing. We want the things.
I understand that, but maybe that is
those
a
things.
Yeah. What's that?
Really?
Not everybody wants those things.
Really,
yeah,
you don't want medical research to make your life healthier, and you know when something goes wrong with your liver, they can replace it. You don't want those things.
Maybe not.
I think that if we look at
society, has a range of opinions on everything. I'm just saying, society as a whole has votes continually for more comforts and better health and those things. I'm not saying that everybody feels that. Some people would like to go one way or the other. But you can tell that that's the driving force in our society because that's why the billions of dollars.
But isn't it possible? And more defense is also one of the things that keep being argued for, which is really about the separation between people, not the connection of people.
Yeah.
But isn't it also possible that at this point that so much of the focus has come to bear on the material, that's where our energies are focused.
And that could be too much.
And it could be too much.
That's what the Pope is saying. That's his message as he travels around the world.
I want to just touch on that little thing about the medical aspect of things. Okay, first of all, not everybody is able to have the medical expertise, you know, finite best that we can have. There's very limited few that can have it.
Oh, but the whole thing, come on, grows, and everybody's average medical care changes too.
Excuse me, let me just finish my little point, because that's part of it. The other part is that now, I just heard this, you know, it was on PBS, it's easy, they can tell how the nutrition aspect of things influences health, okay? Where in China, a gross population, mass population that is poor, eats rice and vegetables and is healthier than the rich population who eats basically what a Western person or our culture would eat. Like that. So on one hand, science has given us a lot, which I think I love science. Okay, I was watched, you know, the moon landing. I think it's the greatest thing. I love that. But there is a limit to it, and the limit is not recognized by scientists. Right?
Those choices in our society are not being made by scientists. If people have more heart attacks,
okay,
it's because they buy more Twinkies, not because scientists have prevented Twinkies.
Well, scientists gave the chemicals.
Yeah, it's true. We invent lots of stuff and people use it in crummy ways. It's not our fault. I'm sorry.
You see, you're, I don't want to accuse you of anything. I'm not blaming you of anything, and I don't think you need to apologize for anything. I'm only saying that this is an observation. It is absolutely not meant for you or towards scientists or towards physicists or anything. But it is an observation of what we talk about, the dominant way of seeing things. It is not, you cannot see on TV that Twinkies are bad for you, let's just use that stupid analogy or thing, because it's not economically justified.
But let's get back to Dante for a minute. In which circle of hell would you put in the people who make the Twinkies, the people who advertise the Twinkies, you know?
And to talk about this, this is getting back to ethics
also. Like, we live in a society which is all about making money. And there's a lot of greed, and some of those doctors are making deals with somebody at the and you're right that a lot of medicine, not all medicine is being developed for the benefit of the whole society. So a lot of things wrong with the scientific medicine and the kind of research that's being done. There's a lot of questions like why is certain kind of research being funded and not certain other kinds?
Yeah, going back to
but ethics, Dante, help.
If there was a more balanced view of other realities, maybe that domination would not happen so easily.
But basically, the people who are being recognized as having the power don't generally give it up to the democratic use. Science cannot be blamed because society does not take care of, if you're going to make people, let people live longer.
control. You can look for people who are pulling the strings, but it's us. And if the world is a mess, and morality is a mess, and health is a mess, it's our choices. And I agree with you completely. I'd love to see this world change. But we're the ones in this country, more than any place else in the world, who dictate all these problems.
And again, that goes back to what Ina was saying. So how do, where is the activity? Where is the activity to change that? You had a
point. Well, one of the things that I'd like to speak to is, in my field, I am a scientist, although you may not consider linguistics a science.
I do.
Oh, good. I feel much better. But in our field, up until the late 50s, the mind was considered nothing. It was just a black box. You couldn't even talk about mind when you talked about language. And then Chomsky came along and said, we've got to bring the mind into it. So we had that revolution happen in one of the sciences. So it's possible to reverse this paradigm, or at least integrate those.
Mm-hmm.
But it just has
to happen
in some of the other problems.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the thing is that mind and consciousness is an enormously hot topic at the moment.
Yeah.
I mean,
that's the really next scientific revolution.
But what worries me about this, what's happening at the moment, is that the whole movement from the scientific community is to simply say that mind is just a secondary phenomena of the buzzing of the neuron. They are, but people like Stuart Kaufman and Patricia Churchland and a whole region, many other, all these Darwinian psychologists, I'm sorry, but they are actively writing
but
and saying
are
just
they saying
that.
Curiosity is, are they saying, I mean, can curiosity be scientifically explained? I feel as well, men and women and human beings are curious and soulful by nature, so I don't believe you can ever truly take the soul out of science or out of anybody. It's part of the human process, and so I believe the attack that it feels like Alan feels attacked, because I feel like it might feel to him that all, you know, artists are saying, because in quotes, you're scientists are not soulful,
yeah.
And I think that
no, that's
passion,
not really what people are saying.
No, I don't think that's what people are saying.
Yeah.
No, I'm saying it might feel like that, being on that side of the attack, and myself being an artist who completely appreciates the sciences and feels like it's just one other side of the spectrum that I'm on, and I don't really want to exist without it. I want it to be a part of me. But, I forgot my point. I mean, it was a real important thing to say that, and I believe that...
You're saying that we're all soulful by nature.
No, we are. I mean, we are very soulful by nature. You can't take that out. Oh, yeah, and the passionate people. I believe the soulfulness, you know, the people that are making the great breakthroughs have that curiosity, in quotes, which can't be explained by science. So it's like science moving ahead, its very lifeblood, is because of the passion and soul and curiosity
exactly.
That is within human nature, that even though the paradigms or the ideas within science don't articulate what those are, they don't, because, as we're saying, they can't be explained. Those particular things, you're saying a feeling is real. I feel it's no less real than an intuition, or can be no more proved than parapsychology, because anything that you're experiencing on a supernatural level, which even I think a feeling is something that is just unique to consciousness. You can never maybe totally describe what you're feeling completely, where, let's say, a mathematical equation, you can. And I just feel like everything that we have been separating out in this discussion, in my consciousness, in my way of looking at life and reality, can't be truly separated out, because it's, does this make any sense? It's
absolutely.
I do understand intellectually where this argument is going, and of course, sciences are funded because they kind of work on this equation that I believe can politically be washed over a little more easily. And believe me, those scientists that have made discoveries that might not economically suit certain societies or certain ways, those people are perhaps, you know, threatened, terrorized, whatever, they get their share. And I think perhaps the arts aren't funded because it seems it's a little more dangerous. But I believe the exploration and curiosities that artists and scientists have are definitely coming from the same soulful, passionate places, a writer would, or somebody who wants to create life. It's all, I believe, the creative
force.
That's
a really important point.
Yeah.
We're going to have to wind up here. I've got one comment here, and I wonder if we have an artist in the crowd who actually uses astronomy or things in space to I don't know exactly, but you actually work in space. And I wonder what your thoughts are at this point.
Yeah, well, I think that the role of the artist, I'm a sculptor, my name is Richard Carr, and since about 1982, I've been interested in using art and technology and science, and I've held a reservation on the space shuttles in 1982 to fly an art payload, which will consist of a sculpture, a satellite that will transmit dolphin voices into space with installations in various galleries and museums on Earth. So as this sculpture satellite orbits the Earth, the dolphin sound will be able to be picked up. And another project that I'm involved with is a collaboration with a composer, and I just presented a paper on this at the International Astronautical Federation in Oslo 3 weeks ago at a symposium on art, space, and society. Mm-hmm. And this piece involves creating a sculpture from orbital debris using some of the 8,000 objects that now orbit the Earth. And the composer I'm working with, Mark Mantel, is generating a musical composition from that data. And I've worked with the Naval Research Laboratory and created a visualization, an actual sculpture of approximately 300 objects that I've selected, and using a supercomputer, a massively parallel computer, you've generated a kinetic visual model of this sculpture as it orbits the Earth. And this is comprised of various objects from the United States, Russia, the European Space Agency, and objects unknown.
And you had a point to make over here?
Oh, no. I mean, it just seems like whatever, just because I think science, and somehow when you start to understand something, people are afraid that it takes a meaning out of it. And I think it sort of takes away sort of what's outside of ourselves, and also when it becomes ourselves, people are afraid of that for some reason. They're afraid of a secular life. And I don't think that necessarily has to be the case, because we still don't understand, but we understand, you know.
Could I'd like to close and read a poem that I found this afternoon. It's an E.E. Cummings poem. All ignorance toboggans into no, and trudges up to ignorance again. But winter's not forever, even snow melts. And if spring should spoil the game, what then? All history's a winter sport, or three. But were it five, I'd still insist that all history is too small for even me, for me and you, exceedingly too small. Swoop, shrill collective myth, into thy grave, merely to toil the scale to shrillerness, per every Madge and Mabel, Dick and Dave. Tomorrow is our permanent address. And there, they'll scarcely find us. If they do, we'll move away still further into now. Thank you all very, very much. Thank you. So very, very much. This was,
I think it was fun.
This it was. I appreciate the risks that you've taken. I appreciate the vulnerability that you've shown. I appreciate the stamina that you've shown. And I just want to thank you all so very, very much for giving us. Yes, and thank the audience as well. The audience has been extraordinary. Thank you all very much.